Hey there, welcome to the Legend of Nobunaga. We are beginning chapter 12 this week, where Nobunaga's going to be putting his foot down on those damn Shogunate forces, who seem to have gathered an army under Nobunaga's rival, Mitsuhide Akechi. Akechi is the commander, along with Yoshiaki Ashikaga, the former shogun. It looks like it's time for a little bit of revenge on these two characters who have been a thorn in Nobunaga's side for a while.
The time has come to put an end to this. Let us march!
Sir!
Mitsuhide has already miraculously survived several near-death experiences, so we'll see if we can kill him this time.
And you, will you sell out your country?
You desire to have Japan. I desire to have even more power. We shall rule Japan. No. Let our combined strength rule the entire world.
Okay, so Mitsuhide seems to have gone mad with power now that Kicho's left him. Poor chap.
Fujitaka has left us and Ieyasu has not yet come. You don't think. Not Ieyasu.
It's so cute.
Don't look at me like that. Such innocence. Maybe I should try to live like you for a time.
Maybe so. I mean, you've died once. I told them all about your dream of death.
When we heard what had happened at Honnoji, we were certain that our Lord Nobunaga had died.
But now, here we are standing together like this.
Yes. Everything is a dream. We are all visions. But think, does it really matter at all?
You fools. Will you stay with me to the very end?
Now that's a stupid question. Right?
Even if my lord were like a ghost, I would follow you.
We all would. For me, there is only one reality, and that is the simple reality of fighting by your side. It doesn't matter if this is a dream or reality. We will fight to win this battle, and then the next, and the next, and the next! Victory, victory, and even more victory, until this world has peace!
Thank you, my friends.
Go, team! Hideyoshi's dialogue there seems very characteristic of his attitudes towards the Korean War, which I'm going to be talking about during the battle for this episode. Nobunaga's been inspired by his lovely friends, inspired to do some more killing.
Let us begin. What say our scouts?
According to the scouts, this is what we face!
So let's see what we face. What has Mitsuhide and Yoshiaki put up for us?
We shall win this battle if we defeat the enemy commander. His lordship has appointed Mitsuhide Akechi as the supreme commander. Ashikaga, Mori, Chosokabe and others have taken the field at his request.
So we're facing all the clans at the moment.
Mitsuhide Akechi is positioned here.
All the clans,
we
not
shall split
allied
into
to
wings
Oda, that
and
is.
Push the attack. Master Tokugawa will be arriving soon.
So the plan seems fairly simple. Just gonna attack Mitsuhide.
This will decide our struggle with the Shogunate forces. Remember those who have fallen. We must not lose now.
Good tip.
My lord, it is time to deploy.
So as it hinted there in the scouting report, Ieyasu Tokugawa should show up at some point on the west side of the map with additional reinforcements, meaning we don't have to worry too much about that side. Mitsuhide is just sitting stationary in this little clearing, so all we really have to do is fight through all these units he's put in these mountain passes to get to where he is and take him out. If only he bunched all his units together and we had to face them all at once, then that would be a challenge, but luckily they're all spread out, so we can just create two battalions to one by one eliminate the pockets of enemy resistance. Adding to the challenge are the cannon batteries, particularly firing down onto the beach area on the west side of the map. Makes moving forward very difficult, but It seems there is a way to get around them if you spend enough time watching their firing patterns, which unfortunately I didn't quite do. I got away without so much damage. It was much better than the battle against the Hojo where I got completely annihilated by cannons, that's for sure. So the condition tells us not to fight under the cannon fire, good idea, and to defeat the enemies, pretty useful. And if I trust Ieyasu to wait for reinforcements, but why would you not trust him, and how could you not wait for reinforcements? There's no way to complete the level without them appearing, as far as I know, so I guess they just had nothing to write in the conditions, so they thought they'd just state the obvious. Right, time to go.
Impressive. Victory is as good as ours.
Our council is at an end. You all know what you have to do. Now go!
So the strategy for this level is fairly simplistic, which is going to be moving up both sides of the map, and then uniting at the end to take on Mitsuhide. The only struggle being the cannons on the beaches, as
we'll
I said.
Fight through their forces, and take Mitsuhide's head! Forward!
Yep, what Nobunaga just said pretty much sums up the strategy I'm going to be using for this level. Quite simple. Perhaps they decided to put a simple level in as the penultimate stage, because next week you're going to be seeing the very last stage, which I imagine is going to be impossible and sort of super complex or something, I don't know. So yes, it's a beach on this west side with all these stockades. You have to find a way to move up without getting hit by the cannons that come down. The east side was much easier, actually.
Now is our chance to attack!
A large amount of the east side actually had no enemy units in it. There's a large section to the north, the forested section, which is actually just devoid of enemies. Right at the beginning, Fujitaka Hosokawa, who was the guy who betrayed Oda, used this ridiculous wind wall attack, which really damaged Toshiya's units. That was a bad start. Apart from that, they're going to have an okay time on the eastern flank. So while we hacked through the enemy forces, I said I was going to tell the story of Hideyoshi's campaign in Korea. I've alluded to this campaign a couple of times so far in The Legend of Nobunaga. So I guess now getting towards the end, I think this is finally my opportunity to actually fit it into the story of what happened historically. Hideyoshi, it seems, was quite the conqueror. He'd always had this dream of uniting both China, Korea, with Japan, in order to form this Pan-Asian Empire, and he supposedly had developed this idea whilst fighting with the Mori. So he was pretty ambitious back then, to think that taking a couple of hundred miles of land would be equivalent to conquering all of Asia in difficulty, but he seemed to think it could be done. There are kind of a couple of ways to interpret Hideyoshi's eventual decision to invade Korea. One way is that it was politically motivated. Some of the forces that Hideyoshi had to command were kind of impetuous and possibly disloyal. Hideyoshi needed something to do with his armies, to put it another way. He needed someone for his armies to be fighting so that they wouldn't fight with him, so that they wouldn't betray him or try and lead an uprising. So this was one motivation for him, to find a new war now that he had conquered all of Japan, find a new war for his troops to fight in. However, it seems that this was not his main goal, because if you look at who actually went on the Korean campaign in terms of officers, most of the officers who were most likely to rebel were most loosely tied to Hideyoshi's band of retainers and his family were the ones who stayed behind in Japan, not the ones that were sent on campaign. So it seems it wasn't so much about Hideyoshi trying to get rid of officers he didn't trust into a foreign land, but just about his own personal ambition. It seems Hideyoshi really did just want to conquer both Korea and China, although much more China than Korea. In fact, the whole ordeal with Korea began with China, Hideyoshi wanting to invade China and trying to get Korea to act as a middleman, to let his forces move through Korea in order to invade China from the north by land, which is much easier than invading China by sea. Now, the Korean Empire, although I believe it's actually a kingdom, yes, the Korean Kingdom, was a long-time ally of China. Their imperial courts of both nations had been in contact for a long time, and they had gone to the point where Korea was kind of like a vassal state of China. It was independently ruled, it had its own king, but it was very much an ally of China, and Hideyoshi must have known this, so it seems that his decision to invade Korea had been made even before he had drop the pretense of actually wanting to invade China. I should explain what actually happened. Hideyoshi started negotiating with Korea, saying, we want to move forces through Korea to invade China, so if you just let us do that, that'll be fine, there'll be peace between Japan and Korea, and no conflict has to be had. So he gave this offer, and sure enough, Korea just said, no, we're allies of China, we're not going to let you do that. And Hideyoshi had basically already begun preparing the invasion force, imagining this was going to happen, and decided to invade Korea. Militarily, if his real goal was to conquer China, invading Korea is actually a very bad idea, because he must have known that the Koreans would resist, and that it would massively slow down his attempt to invade China, and cause all sorts of problems with it, which it did, as we'll hear later on. But the only alternative for Hideyoshi was evading across sea. And going from China to Japan across the sea is actually very difficult, because that area of sea is very tumultuous. It's very dangerous to move a large fleet across that area, especially with Japanese ships, which were just awful given the standard of the time. So Hideyoshi was kind of making a sound decision by saying, well, even though I actually want to invade China, I'm going to invade Korea, just capture it for my own personal amusement. There's no real reason to capture it. There's nothing they can give for us. Let's just have it. And then once we have it, we'll leave and just invade China with most of our forces. Perhaps make Korea somehow a protectorate state of Japan and let them rule themselves or something. So that seemed to be his idea. He gathered up a massive force of about 200,000 troops, probably one of the biggest armies in the Sengoku Jidai era. I guess one of the reasons he was able to gather so many troops was that Japanese people were willing to go abroad, because with the advent of this communication with the West, they had begun to get more and more curious about foreign countries and foreign culture. In fact, around the time, lots of Japanese started immigrating to other countries, particularly China, which was almost unheard of before. There were Japanese colonies forming all over Asia as a general interest in the wider world began to saturate through Japanese culture. And perhaps this was part of the reason Hideyoshi was able to summon so many troops, although I guess his own personal authority will have been most of the reason he simply ordered these troops to follow him. Although I used the word follow him metaphorically, because Hideyoshi himself wouldn't be going on this campaign. He actually did want to go on the campaign. He wanted to lead the forces in Korea, but it was agreed by his retainers that he should not be allowed to do so, because if Hideyoshi left Japan, a nation that he personally had just unified under himself, Japan would probably just fall back into chaos again and the Sengoku Jidai would continue. So they wanted to keep Hideyoshi around just so that Japan could have peace, and Hideyoshi agreed to this and decided not to lead his forces. So he assigned a command of the invasion to some of his subordinate generals. Attack! They had to cross about 50 miles of water between Kyushu Island in southern Japan and the Korean Peninsula. And they managed to do so completely successfully. They achieved 100% strategic surprise on this invasion. The Koreans had no idea, they never noticed the invasion force being built up over the course of several months, and they didn't see the ships coming in basically until they had landed. Despite the fact that you can, on a good day, basically see Korea from Japan, they're not very far away from each other at their closest points. Their closest points being not actually between Korea and the Japanese mainland, but between one of the Japanese, tiny Japanese islands that's about a third of the way between Japan and China, which Hideyoshi was using as a staging post for this invasion.
The battle is getting worse.
So he has 200,000 troops land in Korea. Now what are they going to do now? His strategy was to go straight for the Korean capital, Seoul, and basically just force the country into submission immediately. But his still main strategic goal was to get to China, so he had in mind that he would fight a number of strategic battles at some of the key points that the Korean forces would be able to defend, destroy the Korean armies, and then that would be the end of their resistance. The first point he expected them to defend was just outside Seoul, but for some reason the Koreans decided not to defend it. So instead, the first conflict was going to happen at Seoul, but because of Hideyoshi's complete strategic surprise, they could barely muster any troops to resist Hideyoshi's forces. Basically, the distance between the landing site and Seoul is somewhere near 300 miles. And within about 3 weeks of landing, the Japanese army was at Seoul, the capital. So they'd only been aware they were being invaded for 3 weeks. They had no idea that this 300-mile road could be traversed by such a massive enemy force, and they had not prepared Seoul for invasion at all. Seoul was extremely heavily fortified, so it had that on its side. However, it was so fortified that you had to have nearly 100,000 troops in permanent garrison just in order to have people on the walls. But Seoul could only manage to get just under 10,000 troops together, which meant that the majority of their big walls and fortification system was unmanned. So in fact, Hideyoshi's forces could just capture pieces of the fortification and use them for their own uses, rather than being any sort of deterrent to the invasion. So Seoul was captured easily, and the Korean, well, what was left of the Korean forces and Korean command structure fled north to Korea's second capital of Pyongyang. However, things wouldn't be so easy for the Japanese from now on, because around this time the Korean War Machine was beginning to rev up. The Koreans were gathering troops at Pyongyang and were beginning to think about putting serious resistance to the Japanese's attempt to get towards China. Let's have a little look at what I'm doing in this stage. You can see I have Toshie and his forces moving around this little forested area, and it's kind of like devoid of enemies or devoid of anything. There was a building in there, but you couldn't interact with the building or anything, so it seems like the developers possibly meant to have something there and decided not to do it in the end. I felt like this level was too simplistic, especially for one so late in the game, so perhaps there was some added feature that was supposed to involve the buildings in the forest, but they took that out for some reason. Here you can see I'm fighting Murashige Araki, which you might remember was part of my own forces a while ago, but he betrayed us. And now I'm taking a little bit of revenge on him by completely destroying him from all sides, using Ieyasu and Tadakatsu Honda's reinforcement units who finally showed up to add to my destructive forces.
Yourself off and try again.
So when did the Koreans finally resist the Japanese? Well, it happened at the Battle of Imjin River. Imjin River was an extremely good place to defend from the Korean point of view. It had a wide open north bank and a really narrow south bank approach, which meant the Japanese would have to attack in a big column, whereas the Koreans could arrange in a line and basically have a very large amount of men facing a very small amount of men at any one time. So the Koreans had a massive advantage, and the Japanese realized this. The Japanese refused to attack across the Imjin River. They just sat there and looked at the Koreans and tried to think of a way to get around them. And eventually they did find a way. The Koreans threw away their advantage because the Japanese feigned a retreat. They pulled the oldest trick in the book, basically, pretending to fall back to try and make the Koreans come on to the Japanese side of the river, and they fell for it. In fact, they led the Koreans quite a long ways away from the river, and then staged a massive ambush on their forces, completely destroying the Korean army, with almost no losses to the Japanese army. So suddenly, a little bit of luck on the Japanese side had meant that they had a decisive advantage in the complete campaign to capture Korea. However, things kind of went downhill again almost immediately afterwards, because they were marching north towards Pyongyang after having won this battle at the Imjin River, and they came across almost the exact same situation at Tadong River. The only difference was that Tadong was even more annoying for the Japanese, because the Korean north bank had a massive walled city guarding it, so the Korean defensive position was even stronger than it was before, and it seemed unlikely that they were going to fall for the same trick, especially when they had a nice warm city to be sitting in on their side. So the Japanese needed a way to get across this river to attack Pyongyang. Luckily for them, the Koreans would reveal weaknesses in their own position for them. The Koreans decided to take an offensive strategy. Their plan was to use a night attack on the Japanese camp, crossing the river at night and attacking before daybreak to spread confusion and hopefully rout the Japanese forces. However, the Koreans underestimated how long it would take to cross the river. This was a raging river with very wide berth and a strong current, and they actually found it very difficult to get their men across to the Japanese side. In fact, it took so long that they were still midway through crossing the river when dawn broke, and the Japanese forces spotted this happening. The Koreans kind of panicked and tried to fall back, However, since the Japanese had seen all the points they were crossing, they had then been alerted to all of the best places to cross the river, all the secret fords, or places where the river is shallower than it looks, etc. So using this knowledge, they basically pursued the Korean forces back onto the other side of the river and completely routed the forces before they could return to this walled city. The Korean army was destroyed, and the Japanese could then just occupy the walled city without any resistance, capturing a key part of the Korean economy, because this big city had all sorts of supplies and things which they could use on that campaign. Another massive stroke of luck for the Japanese army.
Fire!
However, from this point onwards, the campaign in Korea would get worse and worse, and would eventually be doomed to failure. For three big reasons, really. The first big reason was that in all of these areas of Korea that Japan were capturing, the Koreans were beginning guerrilla tactics. People were resisting Japanese occupation, and in particular, they were interfering with the Japanese supply lines for their forces, which meant they were beginning to run low of supplies at the battlefronts up near Pyongyang. Then there was the second factor, which was China. China had finally decided to step into the conflict by the time the Japanese forces were beginning to approach Pyongyang, and they decided to take their army and counter-invade Korea on the Korean people's behalf in order to try and get rid of Japan. So the Korean army suddenly shows up at Pyongyang, 100,000 troops strong. Although their troops were inferior to the Japanese, they would always have the local numerical advantage, because the 200,000 troops of the Japanese were spread out over several strong points they were trying to defend across the nation, whereas the Chinese army could amass their 100,000 troops together and attack little subgroups of the Japanese army one at a time. So the Japanese army was now in trouble. They probably could have solved the situation had it not been for the third big problem that they have, which was the Korean naval superiority. This invasion was taking place across sea, so to reinforce, you would need constant sea routes between Korea and Japan to be secured. However, Japan had a famously low-quality navy at this point in history. It could not stand up to anything the Koreans put out onto the sea. Hideyoshi apparently knew this, because before the invasion he had been trying to increase the quality of his navy. In particular, he had been trying to buy ships from the Portuguese, I think, some big sort of European-style galleons, which would have completely dominated in that area of Asia, because there was nothing that could stand up to them. However, he failed to do this, and instead the invasion took place with the low-quality, box-like Japanese ships, which would have very, very poor combat ability, mainly because they have no cover, so that Korean forces, when they attacked, could easily see all of the soldiers on the decks. The decks were just big flat squares with no walls, so they could just see the Japanese archers and Japanese gunmen on the deck and take them out, whereas the Korean ships had almost complete cover from the Japanese fire. Their ships were like turtles. They had armored sides and armored roofs with armor made out of wood or metal, and the sides of the ships were covered in spikes to make it almost impossible to properly do a boarding motion. So these little Korean turtle ships were pretty much invincible compared to the Japanese boxes. They would just roll up, they would fire rifles through portholes in the turtle's shell, if you want, which would just take out everyone on the deck of these Japanese ships. Guys on the deck had no way to hide from this rifle fire. All they had were the small wooden railings on the sides, which could do almost nothing to stop the musket balls. In this way, the Korean Navy was able to defeat Japanese navies that were far superior in terms of size. There was one particular battle where a Korean Navy defeated the Japanese fleet that was 10 times its size, with losing almost none of its own ships. An incredible achievement, mainly down to the fact that the Japanese ships were just not cut to naval conflict in the wider world. It got to the point in late 1592 when Hideyoshi realized his forces were in trouble. All three of these factors had taken a hit. They were low on supplies, They were being attacked by the Chinese and Korean armies, and their link to Japan was being cut off continuously by constant raids by the Korean Navy. Hideyoshi saw fit to negotiate in this situation. He negotiated a temporary peace, and Japanese forces in Korea moved to the southern area of Korea, where there's a little area that they were allowed to live in. I think the area was actually a former Japanese colony in Korea, where the Japanese forces were all moved there as part of a peace deal. I think they must have stayed there for quite a long time. There was a short period of trade and of a cultural exchange between Korea and Japan, as Japanese generals sent home stories and sent home artifacts from Korea. But there would eventually come a point when one of the sort of minor deals of the ceasefire arrangement would be broken. I believe it was broken by China. China's part of the deal for the ceasefire was that they would provide, I think the daughter of their emperor or something was to be provided to marry into one of the Japanese noble families, and they failed to do this, which is completely fair for them, because it was an outrageous claim from Hideyoshi to ask them to do this, because the Chinese imperial family and the Japanese noble families were not equal in status in any way. It would have been very insulting to China to actually agree to this condition, but they just pretended to agree with it to get the ceasefire to work, and then just never went along with it. And Hideyoshi took this as an excuse to launch a second invasion of Korea. This took place 5 years later in 1597. The second invasion of Korea would have all the same problems as the first one, and none of the successes. It didn't have the same luck. So it didn't have the whole penetrating all the way up to Pyongyang. They basically invaded, took only a couple of minor forts around the area that the Japanese already controlled from the results of the last invasion, and ended up getting bogged down. They got locked into conflict with the Korean army, which was now much more ready for an invasion, having sort of being tipped off by the fact that the Japanese armies were around, that they should maintain a state of readiness. There came a point very soon when the majority of the Japanese force actually just got trapped in a fortress, and the whole campaign was locked down into just a siege battle between the massive Japanese and Korean armies just facing off over a fortress. Let's have a little look at what's going on in the stage. You can see I'm gradually working my way towards Mitsuhide. I've taken out huge banks of cannons. So now the majority of the enemy's cannons are debunked, except for one set, which is over by Mitsuhide and is firing down to near where Toshie is right now. Not quite hitting him, but getting very close, so I'm going to have to be careful in this area. Toshie actually took quite a beating fighting this enemy unit, Hidemitsu Akechi. Hidemitsu was the guy that we tried to assassinate when Nobunaga was making his comeback. I believe we failed, and now we're paying the price because he proved to be quite a strong unit. Over on the west side, complete dominance is happening because I have such numerical superiority. Teramoto Mori got trapped in the corner and got completely destroyed by four or five units there continuously wailing on him. So now all I have to do is defeat Hidemitsu, and then I can move into Akechi's little section that he's carved out in the forest to see if he has any more units hidden there, and then defeat the man himself.
Stay out of Lord Nobunaga's way!
So how did the second invasion of Korea end for Hideyoshi? Well, as I said, they got to a point in 1598 when all of his forces were trapped in a siege, but later in 1598, Hideyoshi himself would die, and this event would allow the negotiation of an armistice with the Chinese and Korean forces between the remaining Japanese forces. And as part of the armistice, they were allowed to go back to Japan. So the second invasion achieved basically nothing at all, and ended almost as soon as it had begun. Japanese forces returned to Japan, and not for hundreds of years would they ever go and bother Korea again. Japan would invade Korea, I believe, twice more in the future. Most recently in 1906, I think, as part of the Russo-Japanese War. But anyway, the campaigns in Korea, suffice to say, came to a rather stalematey conclusion. Neither side had gained anything. In particular, the Korean side, you could say, had lost a lot, because whilst Japan was in the country, they basically ravaged it. The Korean people were sent into an era of poverty as a result of the Japanese campaigning. It went very bad for the people of Korea. A lot of their wealth was destroyed.
Nobunaga, I shall defeat you and rebuild this land!
So here's Mitsuhide, he's got a lot to shout about. Not much to back it up though. So yes, the Korean people fared very badly. The Japanese people, I guess they actually came out on top. Particularly because there were some, a couple of advantages that did come with the Korean War. Non-military advantages. Although I guess you could call the Japanese exposure to Korean and Chinese naval warfare as a military advantage, because they learned from the experience how ineffective their own naval forces were. But the main thing they gained was technological and cultural, because it forced some exposure between the cultures of Japan, China and Korea. And now Korea and China were much more technologically advanced than Japan at the time. So Japan was able to steal some of the technology while they were there. I guess one of the most important pieces they stole would have been the printing press. Japanese literature at the time was still the classical calligraphy style, where people would paint figures onto paper in order to create books, an extremely time-consuming and inaccurate process. But as a result of the invasions of Korea, they were giving access to the printing press, to movable type, giving them the ability to print actual book-like documents, which would allow much more easy spreading of knowledge. So that was something very useful to them. There were lots of cultural things as well. For example, they got lots of paintings, painting techniques, lots of pottery techniques too, were stolen from Korean artisans whilst they were over there. So the Japanese did gain something, but they gained very little compared to the Koreans losing a lot. So still, a very one-sided conflict. Many lost their lives, in the end it was for nothing, and I guess Hideyoshi is to blame.
Retreat! We must regroup and attack Nobunaga!
So Mitsuhide gives two contradictory orders, and then rides off into the distance.
Celebrate! Victory is ours!
There you go. A nice easy victory. So near the end of the game as well. I bet next week will be a little bit harder. So I managed to get the rank S in the final battle of Harima. Wasn't it called the decisive battle of Harima? At the beginning? I don't know, maybe they've changed the name of the stage. Anyway, we've got Balmung, a weapon for Amalia, mounted Sakai rifle monks, a generic unit. These Gyoki robes, they look pretty cool. Not sure if they're any good though. And Inodome rifles, another rifle unit. I have no rifle generals in my force, so all these rifle units I get, I never put them to use, I just sell them. I have a lot of money in the game. I have something like 350,000 gold, which is more than you'd ever need. You just buy everything in the shop with that amount. Loads of levels up, and especially cool that Masashi Miyamoto got promoted, so he's going to have extra health in the next stage.
The enemy is starting to crumble. Our forces have gained a great victory.
Lord Nobunaga, I beg your humble forgiveness for arriving to the battle late.
What was the problem?
I'm ashamed to admit it, but because of Mitsuhide, certain of my retainers staged a rebellion.
Ieyasu, forgive me.
Huh?
Right! Let's reform the men and pursue Mitsuhide!
Good idea, Nobunaga.
Now you shall bear witness! You shall see the power of my country!
Excellent! What a brave, glorious sight. Nobunaga can never match such an overwhelming force.
Oh dear.
We have won! With this, our victory is assured!
So Mitsuhide seems to have stumbled across a massive Spanish armada, which was just sitting off Kyushu Island. Now he's going to use it against us.
2 months have passed since the Oda army defeated the Shogunate forces at Harima. Nobunaga had begun to march west. His purpose? To end the fight with Mitsuhide, once and for all. In opposition, in Kyushu, the Shogunate forces were joined by the main Shimazu force from Satsuma and the Spanish army, who had landed at Hakata. They prepared to intercept the Oda forces.
So the enemy is a combined force of Shogunate Shimazu and Spanish forces.
Nobunaga Oda and Mitsuhide Akechi. The final battle between these two heroes was about to start.
It's Kessen time. All of our opponents' forces begin with the letter S. Coincidence?
Right. It's time. Are you ready?
Sir!
My lord, here's the situation.
So now, we only have one decisive battle left, and it's the final stage in the game. We're finally going to show Mitsuhide Akechi who is the true ruler of Japan, once and for all. And perhaps take a little bit of revenge on Ashikaga yet again for his constant meddling in our affairs. If you play through the game a second time, I believe this actually isn't the end of the game, and you can continue beyond this into a chapter 13, but that's not historical in any way, it's just a bonus chapter for hardcore players. Anyway, looks like we've got something to look forward to next week on The Legend of Nobunaga, taking on the final battle with Mitsuhide, and settling the score and seeing how Nobunaga's story, at least in the game, comes to an end. I guess I'll also tell you the story of how the Sengoku Jidai era came to an end, and how Ieyasu Tokugawa came to rule Japan. That's actually quite a big jump ahead from the invasions of Korea under Hideyoshi, but I'd like to wrap things up, tell you how it all ended, as we see how it ends in the legend. So for now, I wish you a very nice week, and I'll see you next time on The Legend of Nobunaga.